الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد. So as I had discussed last time, inshallah ta'ala, we will begin with the next batch of Sahaba. And as I said, we are not doing a history of the Khulafa Ar-Rashidoon and their era after them. Rather, what we're doing is the lives of the Sahaba. And so we now move on to another Sahabi. And the Sahabi we're going to do today is actually one of the promised 10, one of the Ashara Mubash'ara. Now, before we jump into his biography, I thought it's useful to remind ourselves and to learn and to study what is this concept of Ashara Mubash'ara. Where do we get it from? Why do we say that some of the Sahaba are Ashara Mubash'ara, and what is the evidence for this? Now, realize that the fact of the matter is that the Quran and Sunnah is full of tabshir. Tabshir is good news, right? In fact, the Prophet ﷺ was sent as a mubashiran wa nadhira. So, mubashir is the one who brings good news. And the Prophet ﷺ gave glad tidings, gave good news to many categories of people. And the good news here is the news of Jannah. There's only one news that is so good that qualifies the Prophet ﷺ to be mubashir. The biggest, best news is that of Jannah. And so the Quran has وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ, right? وَبَشِّرِ this, وَبَشِّرِ that. And the hadith as well has categories of bashara, of good news. So for example, who can give me any hadith that has bashir so and so? Any hadith? Give glad tidings to? No, categories of people. Categories. I gave them quite a few of them in the khatiras in Ramadan especially we gave. One of the main ones I always emphasize is بَشِّرِ الْمَشَّائِنَ فِي الظُّلَمِ بِالنُّورِ التَّامِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Give glad tidings to those who walk to the masjid in dark, i.e. who pray Fajr and Isha. So there's بَشِّر, give glad tidings. Our Prophet as well said, بَشِّر, give glad tidings to those who say لا إله إلا الله from their hearts, that they're going to enter Jannah. And our Prophet gave glad tidings to those who love one another for sake of Allah. So these are all categories. But what we're interested in, it, where did the Prophet give bashara to specific sahaba? Where did he give good news to specific Sahaba? So there are many Sahaba who have been promised paradise even while they are alive. And there are 10 who have a special status. Now let me repeat that. There are many Sahaba who have been promised paradise while they were alive. How many? More than 10. More than 10. And of course, it depends on which hadith is sahih or not, but definitely at least around 15 or so we know for sure have been promised paradise while they are alive. But then there are 10 that are considered to be Ashara Mubash'ara. Why, when more than 10 have been promised paradise, are only 10 called Ashara Mubash'ara? Do you understand the question? Right? Why is it that these 10 have a special category? Well, they are considered to have a special category, very simplistically, because they are all mentioned in hadith by name, 10, beginning to end. Okay? So, in a number of traditions, these 10 are marked out, and the others are not mentioned. So, because of this, they are considered to be the Ashara Mubash'ara. And I'll quote you only two of them. The first of them is Sunan At-Tirmidhi or Jam' At-Tirmidhi, hadith number 3747. So, from Sunan At-Tirmidhi or from Jam' At-Tirmidhi, that Abdurrahman ibn Auf said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, so this is the hadith, okay, listen to me now. This is straight from the chapter of the blessings of the Sahaba in Sunan At-Tirmidhi. So, Abdurrahman ibn Auf reported that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Abu Bakrin fil Jannah, wa Umar fil Jannah, وعثمان في الجنة وعلي في الجنة وطلحة في الجنة والزبير في الجنة وعبد الرحمن بن عوف في الجنة وسعد في الجنة وسعيد في الجنة وأبو عبيدة عامر بن جراح في الجنة. Exactly 10. Do I need to translate that or it's pretty clear? Okay. Each one of these 10 في الجنة في الجنة في الجنة في الجنة. End of hadith. So this is a hadith. And so in this hadith, quite literally, exactly 10 Sahaba are mentioned. Exactly 10 Sahaba are mentioned. And we have another hadith reported by Sa'id ibn Zayd that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Asharatun fil Jannah. This is the hadith. Another hadith reported by another Sahabi, right? Asharatun fil Jannah. 10 are the people in Jannah. But this hadith has a slight difference. It said Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, Zubayr, Talha, Abdurrahman, Abu Ubaidah, Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqqas, and then he counted all of these, and then he was silent on the 10th one. So they said, we ask you by Allah, who is the 10th one? Tell us who the 10th one is. So then the narrator is Sa'id ibn Zayd. He said, the next one is Abu al-A'war. And Abu al-A'war is the father of the one who has, yani, basically not one eye is missing, let's say. Okay? And he meant by this is himself. Sa'id ibn Zayd is the 10th of the 10. Sa'id ibn Zayd is the 10th of the 10. And he didn't want to give the name of the 10th. So he stopped at 9. Then they said, we ask you by Allah, you said 10, where is the 10th? Then after a while he said, the 10th one is Abu al-A'war, meaning he's trying to deprecate himself, he's trying to put himself down. Like, I don't deserve to be in this, but the Prophet ﷺ said that, Abu al-A'war, or, you know, and that's his own kunya, Sa'id ibn Zayd, is in Jannah. So these are two ahadith in Sunan at-Tirmidhi, another beautiful hadith in Musnad Imam Ahmad as well, volume 3, page 165. Where we have a similar hadith, but it has a longer story to it. It has a longer story to it. Hadith number 1630. Hadith number 1630. That Al-Mughira ibn Shu'ba was sitting in the big masjid of Basra. Mughira ibn Shu'ba was in Basra. In Kufa. It's not Basra, Kufa. Mughira was in Kufa. And he had the people around him in the grand masjid. So Mughira was appointed the governor of Kufa, and he was basically sitting in the majlis. And a man came and sat down in front of Al-Mughira, but Al-Mughira put him up close to him. And this is Sa'id ibn Zayd, ibn Amr ibn Rufail. Sa'id ibn Zayd is the last 10th of the 10. And while they were sitting there, a person began to curse Ali ibn Abi Talib. So this is during the reign of the fitna between Muawiyah, and after that, during the time of Muawiyah as well. As we know, some of the Bedouins and some of the people began to hate on Ali ibn Abi Talib. So in front of Al-Mughira, somebody begins to say bad things about Ali ibn Abi Talib. So this person, who is of course Sa'id ibn Zayd, said, aren't you hearing what he is saying? Somebody is cursing Ali and you do not respond back to him? You do not respond back to him. So if you're not going to say something, I'm going to say something. I swear that I heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say, and my ears heard it and my heart memorized it. So he is now making a qasam here. I know what I heard, my ears heard it and my heart memorized it, and I would never lie about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because my Lord will ask me when I met him. So he is now giving so many building up that I'm not going to lie. That he said, Abu Bakr fil Jannah, and Umar fil Jannah, and Ali fil Jannah, and Uthman fil Jannah, and Talha fil Jannah, Zubair fil Jannah, Abdurrahman fil Jannah, wa Sa'ad ibn Malikin fil Jannah. And the 9th one of the believers, if I wanted to mention his name, I would mention him. And they said, tell us who is that person, tell us who is that person. And so he said, I am that 10th person, or I am the last person that was mentioned. So, and this is Sa'id ibn Zayd, he was, as we said, humble to not put himself. He said, if I wanted to, I could tell you. Then they said, no, tell us. So then he basically said that, okay, I am that person of them. So these ahadith all put together, narrated by multiple Sahaba, explicitly indicate what? That the Ashara Mubash'ara have been mentioned by name one after the other in one hadith. So, therefore, as far as I'm aware, there is no ikhtilaf who these 10 are. These 10 unanimously agreed. Who are they? So please, now, one of the things I request all of you to memorize Ashara Mubash'ara. Right? Just like, yani, we should memorize the famous battles, we should memorize, so it is not befitting that we don't know the Ashara Mubash'ara of the Sahaba. Okay? So, number one, everybody knows. Abu Bakr, 2, 3, 4, we know, okay? Umar, Uthman, Ali, okay? Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali. Then after this, there's no tartib per se. There's no like order in hierarchy. These four, their order is because of their khilafah. So we know their order. And as we said, Ali and Uthman radiallahu anhum, they're very close to one another. And so some people from early Islam would prefer Uthman, Ali over Uthman. But then eventually the bulk of the majority, they said Uthman over Ali. And the point is that we're very close to one another. But the rest of the six, there's no specific tartib, okay? So however you memorize them, it is fine. And they are Talha and Zubayr. You can remember Talha and Zubayr, that they both died in the Battle of the Camel. So just remember like this, Talha and Zubayr, they are together. They were fought on the side of Aisha in the Battle of the Camel. So there we have five and six, Talha and Zubayr. Then we have Abdurrahman ibn Auf and Abu Ubaidah Amir ibn al-Jarrah. That's seven and eight. So Abdurrahman ibn Auf and Abu Ubaidah Amir ibn al-Jarrah. And then the last two, just memorize Sa'ad and Sa'id. Sa'ad, which one? Ibn Abi Waqqas. And the 10th one that most people don't know and they haven't thought about and they don't really know even is Sa'id ibn Zayd. And of course, that's why we're here. Inshallah, we'll have a class on Sa'id ibn Zayd. And who is he? Sa'id ibn Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufayl. He is the 10th one, Sa'id ibn Zayd. Okay, and he's the one who narrated this hadith, that I am that 10th one. And I'm, you know, he didn't want to put it out like this. Okay, so once again, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, Talha and Zubayr, right? Abdurrahman ibn Auf, right? And then Abu Ubaidah Amr ibn Jarrah, and then Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, and then Sa'id ibn Zayd. These are the 10 Ashara Mubash'ara. Now, one point about them. They are all from the Quraysh. They are all from the Quraysh. Okay? Why do you think this is the case? Not because of astaghfirullah asabiyya or tribalism, but because what they did in Mecca, nobody could make up in Medina. What they did in Mecca and the trials that they had to undergo and the torture and the efforts that they did and their dedication and loyalty, nobody could come close to that, no matter how much they did in the Medinan phase, right? وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ, as Allah says. The ones who won early, they're the ones who are the first. The sabiq is the awwal. The sabiq is the ones who are the first. Meaning in time. Al-awwal means they won the race. They're in the front. As-sabiquna al-awwaluna. They are the ones who are basically going to go to the highest. So all of them are from the Quraysh. Now very quickly, just to give you a tidbit about their genealogy and whatnot. So the Quraysh, as we know, is many sub-tribes, right? Who amongst these 10 is the closest in lineage to the Prophet ﷺ? Everybody should know. Ali radiallahu anhu, right? Obviously. And Ali is the only Hashimi from these 10. Ali is the only Hashimi from these 10. Then the next close in kin is Zubayr. Zubayr ibn al-Awwam. And Zubayr is from the tribe of Banu Abdul Uzza. And in fact, from his mother's side, his paternal aunt, I should say, sorry. So his father's sister. His father's sister is Khadija. Okay? So his aunt, Zubayr's aunt is Khadija. Okay, but obviously that's not a blood lineage. That's a lineage by marriage. That's not a blood relationship. It's a relationship by marriage. So Zubayr is from the tribe of Banu Abdul Uzza, and he is the next closest in kin. Then the next is Uthman ibn Affan. And Uthman ibn Affan is from the tribe of Banu Umayyah, as we know. And the Banu Umayyah joins with the Prophet after four generations. Okay. Then the next are two people. They are both exactly the same, five generations between him, them and the Prophet. And that is Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas and Abdurrahman ibn Auf. They are both from the tribe of the Banu Zuhra. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas and Abdurrahman ibn Auf, they are both from the tribe of Banu Zuhra. But Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas has a double relationship. So from the father's side, which is how Islam calculates nasab, right? From the father's side, yes, five generations. But Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas is a first cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam through Amina. So Amina's brother is Sa'd's father. Clear? So Amina is also from the tribe of the Banu Zuhra. Amina binti Wahab, right? So Wahab, this Wahab is Sa'd's grandfather. Amina binti Wahab, okay? Wahab is Sa'd's grandfather. And so Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, they're first cousins with the Prophet ﷺ, but not from the father's side, from the mother's side, Amina's side. Okay, from Amina's side, he is the first cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then the next group of people is the Banu Taym. the category of Banu Taym, the tribe of Banu Taym, and there are two of these six from the tribe of, there are two of these ten from the tribe of Banu Taym. Who is the first of the Banu Taym guys? Abu Bakr At-Taymi. Abu Bakr At-Taymi. Abu Bakr is from the Banu Taym. Abu Bakr, and can you remind me how many generations do they match up with the Prophet? Very good, six. Abu Bakr and the Prophet, six generations. Okay, that's Banu Taym. And Abu Bakr has a cousin, a second cousin, and that is Talha. Talha, and that's what we're going to talk about today, by the way. Talha and Abu Bakr are basically children of cousins, so they're second cousins. So their fathers are first cousins, their grandfathers are brothers. Simple. So Talha's father's father and Abu Qahafa's father, Abu Bakr ibn Abi Qahafa, they are full brothers. So these are two brothers, their grandsons. So, and obviously, by the way, even now to this day, we know who our cousins, and many times we know our second cousins. In Jahiliyyah, in pre-Islam and in early Islam, this means everything. This means everything. You are defined by your cousins and second cousins. You know exactly how you're related to everybody else. So these are very important factors for early Islam. So the Banu Taym have two, and that is Abu Bakr and Talha. Then after them are another two, and they're also related together, and that is the Banu Adi. And the Banu Adi is Umar ibn Khattab, Banu Adi. And how many between him and the Prophet ﷺ? When do they combine? Eight. The Banu Adi, eight. Between Umar and the Prophet ﷺ, go back eight generations, you get the same person. Okay, so we're going back yani at least 300 years or so, and that becomes the Banu Adi. And Umar ibn Khattab is from the Banu Adi, and Umar's brother, Umar's uncle has a son, and that is Zayd. And so Sa'id ibn Zayd, they are cousins to Umar ibn al-Khattab. So Sa'id ibn Zayd and Umar ibn al-Khattab are both from the Banu Adi. So let me just clarify. Sa'id ibn Zayd. Zayd and Umar are cousins, first cousins. So Sa'id is one level below. Okay, Zayd, his father, and Umar are first cousins. So Sa'id is the younger, he's the youngest of these ten as well, by the way. So he is the one level below Umar. So between him and the Prophet is nine people, because he has an extra person there. But his father is the famous, Sa'id ibn Zayd's father is the famous Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufail, whom we began the seerah with 5 years ago. The second lecture was all about Zayd ibn Amr ibn Nufail. Remember, or anybody remember Zayd ibn Amr, or we are completely forgotten? One person remembers, alhamdulillah. Okay, that's good, alhamdulillah. Okay, and then there's one left, and that is the furthest person, and that is Abu Ubaidah Amir ibn al-Jarrah. And basically his tribe is, his sub-tribe is the furthest sub-tribe from the Banu Hashim out of all of the Quraysh. And in fact, they only meet together at Quraysh directly. So they go back, I think, 10 or 11 generations. So Abu Ubaidah Amir ibn al-Jarrah is the farthest in terms of nasab, but they're all Qurashi. Now, we said these are the 10 that have been mentioned in a hadith, and therefore they get a special status. Okay, are they the only that have been promised paradise? No. Who can tell me other Sahaba whom the Prophet ﷺ said, as they're alive, they're still alive? Who can tell me other names that the Prophet ﷺ said to them something that indicates they're people of Jannah? Number one, Bilal. What did he say to Bilal radiallahu anhu? So I heard the flip-flop of your yani footsteps, the slapping sound of your footsteps in Jannah. Which means Bilal is of the Mubasharun bil Jannah, but he's not of the 10. Okay? Because the hadith says Asharatun fil Jannah, then it mentions 10. So Bilal is of the elite of the Sahaba, but he's not of those 10. Clear? Okay, so that's definitely one person. Who else was told that he would be a person of Jannah? Very good. Al Yasir, right? May Allah make my family as well from the people of Jannah, inshallah. But the real Al Yasir, not this Al Yasir. Al Yasir, sabran Al Yasir, fa inna maw'idakum al Jannah, right? Be patient, O family of Yasir, for verily your place is in Jannah. And that's Al Yasir, so that's Yasir and Sumayya. And then who else is included in Al Yasir? Ammar. And Ammar has a double privilege. Ammar ibn Yasir has a double privilege. Not only does he come under Sabran ala Yasir, but there's another hadith about Ammar, right? That you're going to die a shaheed and the Baghiya group is going to kill you, right? So there's another blessing in that one, even though that one is not explicit about Jannah. But it's still an indirect blessing that you're going to die a shaheed. And when the Prophet says that, then what does that mean? So it's like 1 plus 1 equals 2. He didn't say directly to Ammar, other than Sabran Ali Asr, but the point is, when you get that prediction, what does that imply? It implies basically Jannah. So we have Ammar ibn Yasir. Who else was given, and Ali Asr, who else was given the good news of Jannah? Who? By name, who? Which one, how, where, what? Give me a name.
So, you have four.
But where? Where? Okay, so that's good, but there's a more explicit hadith. There's an even more explicit hadith. Hadith in Sahih Bukhari. The Prophet is in Mecca, and he's sitting with Khadija. And he says to Khadija, Jibreel has come to me to give salams to you from your Lord, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to give you glad tidings of a house in Jannah in which there is no tiredness and no noise. Okay? The hadith is in Bukhari. So this is good news for Jannah. Khadija explicitly got told, you're getting into Jannah. Okay? Who else? Fatima, indirectly, yes, that is true. Very good. Hassan and Hussein. Hassan and Hussein, the both of them. The hadith says, Hassan and Hussein, Sayyida Shababi Ahlil Jannah, wa abuhuma khayran minhuma. Hassan and Hussein, radiallahu anhuma, are the leaders of the young men of Jannah. We can also add Ukasha ibn Mihsan, the famous hadith narrator of the Sahaba, the famous hadith of 70,000 entering Jannah without hisab. The Prophet said, 70,000 of my ummah will enter Jannah without hisab. Ukasha said, Ya Rasulullah, make dua that Allah makes me amongst them. So the Prophet said, you are amongst them. Then another man stood up and said, make dua as well for me. And the Prophet said, Sabaqaka biha Ukasha. Ukasha was the first. That's it. I can't keep on opening this door. Okay. So Ukasha has been told, you are amongst them. So that's another person. And there are maybe a few others that are. Now, there are quite a few who, when they died, their families were told that they are in Jannah. Okay? There's a big difference between being told yourself and then you've moved on and their families are told. Some examples of this one. Just to... Hamza, very good. Sa'd, very good. Sa'd ibn Malik, very good. Who else? Mus'ab ibn Umayr, very good. Who else? Ja'far, the cousin of the Prophet ﷺ, right? Ja'far, he went to the house of Ja'far, remember? He rubbed the yatim of Ja'far, and he said, Allah has given your father wings instead of his arms in Jannah, right? So we have Ja'far as well. Jabir ibn Abdullah was told his father, Abdullah ibn Haram, is in Jannah. So Jabir was told, he was very sad. His father had died. He had left like 7 sisters, no brothers. So he has 7 sisters to take care of and no brothers. And he was very, very distraught. And the Prophet consoled him and said, you know, Allah Azza wa Jal spoke to your father without any veil between them. And he said to them, so the hadith is also there. So the point being, many people, beyond the 10, many people have been told, and we know at least 5 or 6 that have been told. And then many people have been told after they die, the rest of the Sahaba are told, especially Shaheed, by the way. A number of Shaheeds in Badr, Uhud, whatnot, we come across. Even the Yahudi that died the day of Uhud, right? He didn't even pray one salah. And the Prophet told us he's in Jannah, right? So he accepted Islam and he fought, and then he had dakhal al-Jannah, he didn't even pray salah salatan qat. He didn't pray any salah and he got into Jannah. So those that are told Jannah after they have gone to other family members or to the Muslim community is more than Ashara. There's more than the 10. But those that are, as we said, the 10 are indeed the highest of the high. And that's why we call them Ashara Mubash'ara, because of these hadith. Simple as that. Asharatun fil Jannah. So these are the Ashara Mubash'ara. But please understand, there are more than 10. Okay, tayyib.
Conquered Istanbul, like the Abul army and the one who conquered
It doesn't say they will be in Jannah. It does not say that they will all be in Jannah. Not at all. Rather, it gives them good news. The best army is this or that. It doesn't say they will be in Jannah. So they are a good army. It does not mean each and every one amongst them is automatically going to enter Jannah. It's just a blessing that the Prophet is giving to that entire army. Tayyib, so today, inshallah ta'ala, with that long introduction, because we needed that, because now, for the next few weeks, we'll be doing the rest of the six, right? So today, inshallah, we'll finish up one of the six. Now, obviously, because none of these other six really held positions of political power, they weren't prominent politically, so the ma'lumat, the knowledge about them is much less compared to Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, radiallahu anhum. And we will see this when we get to the later Sahaba. We might even combine two or three Sahaba in one lecture. That's all we know about them. So subhanAllah, we just know their name and biography and basic things. So today, inshallah, I will choose the fifth of them, and that is Talha ibn Ubaydullah, who is typically mentioned as the fifth of these, even though we said there's no actual tarteeb. But if we were to posit a tarteeb, no doubt Sa'id ibn Zayd will be the last, because there is the least knowledge about him, and because as well he was the youngest really of the ten. So even though they're all Ashara Mubash'ara, but still there's no doubt. And then as for the fifth, if we had to put somebody, then yani Talha and Zubayr, the both of them really are together. And they're always mentioned together. Talha and Zubayr are also very good friends together. So today we'll do Talha, and inshallah next Wednesday, inshallah ta'ala, we'll do Zubayr ibn al-Awwam. So Talha ibn Ubaydullah. Talha ibn Ubaydullah, his full name very quickly is Abu Muhammad Talha ibn Ubaydullah ibn Uthman ibn Amr ibn Ka'b ibn Sa'd ibn Taym ibn Murra ibn Ka'b. Murra ibn Ka'b is where it meets with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And one of the very interesting things about Talha was that he was one of the very few people whose mother also converted to Islam and also performed the hijrah with him. So Talha got the blessing of having his mother convert to Islam, and she performed the hijrah, and she passed away, and we don't know anything else about her other than that one little tidbit. Now Talha has many blessings, many fada'il. Firstly, he is of the 10 who are promised paradise. Secondly, he is of the first 10 to convert to Islam. In fact, he is the 8th to convert to Islam. The 8th person to convert to Islam is Talha ibn Ubaydullah. And thirdly, he is one of the famous 5 who converted at the hands of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Okay? So, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq gave da'wah as soon as he became Muslim, and 5 people converted at the hands of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, and they are essentially all of them Mubasharun bil Jannah. So, Zubayr converted at the hands of Abu Bakr, Talha, right? Uthman ibn Affan, and Sa'd ibn Abi Waqas, and Abdurrahman ibn Auf, and all of these are Mubashara bil Jannah. So subhanAllah, Abu Bakr is quite literally, yani Allah Azza wa Jalla blessed him to bring 5 of the best Sahaba of the Prophet to Islam. SubhanAllah, what an amazing blessing, right? So Talha is one of those that Abu Bakr gave da'wah to. And of course, of the blessings of Talha as well, is that he was one of the 6. What six? One of the 6 at the death of selection committee. Khilafah selection committee. Right? Umar ibn Khattab selection committee. He's one of the 6. So these are all very elite categories, and he's in every single one of them. And there are a number of blessings mentioned in the hadith. Of them, we just mentioned 2 of them. The Ashara Mubash'ara hadith, obviously he's in it. Of the hadith that are mentioned about Talha, is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that Talha is of those who mimman qada nahbahu. Now this is a Quranic phrase. Surah Al-Ahzab, فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ قَضَى نَحْبَهُ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَنْتَظِرُ. There are some of the Sahaba who have fulfilled their covenant with Allah, and there are others who are waiting to fulfill it. فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ قَضَى نَحْبَهُ. So this is a Quranic phrase. And the Prophet once pointed to Talha, and he said, this person is of those, Talha is of those who have قَضَى نَحْبَهُ. He has fulfilled his promise to Allah and passed the test. In other words, he's basically being told, you passed the test. He's being told. So that's one of the ways of Bushra as well. It is also mentioned in the hadith in Mustadrak of Al-Hakim that one day during, some say it is during the time of Ahzab, some say it is during other times, where there was a severe drought and people were hungry and there was no food, that Talha was so generous that he slaughtered a camel when they most needed it, because camels are very precious and you don't slaughter them for meat unless it's a very big occasion. So during this occasion, he slaughtered a camel and he in fact dug a well to find water for the Prophet ﷺ, and then he invited him to a feast because they were very hungry at the time. So the Prophet ﷺ said to him, Talha al-Fayyad, Talha, the one who is overflowing with generosity. So that is one of his nicknames, al-Fayyad with a dad, al-Fayyad. Fayda, yani fada yafudu, is to overflow. So al-Fayyad, the one who is overflowing with generosity. And we will see throughout his life that Talha was very, very generous. It is rare to find such a sahabi. And of the blessings of Talha mentioned in the hadith, it is authentically narrated that the Prophet ﷺ predicted that Talha would die a shaheed. It is narrated in Sahih Muslim that one day outside of Mecca, the Prophet ﷺ was walking outside of Mecca, and they were walking on Ghar Hira, Mount of Hira, and the Prophet ﷺ said to Hira, this hadith, by the way, has been narrated in the Uhud as well, Uthbut Uhud, and it's mentioned Uthbut Hira. So there are both two separate instances. And in this hadith, we don't have, in the Uhud one, by the way, who was it? Abu Bakr, Umar, the Prophet ﷺ, Abu Bakr and Umar, right? In this hadith, which is in Mecca, there was in fact Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, Zubair, Sa'd, and Talha. Okay? Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, and Zubair, Sa'd, and Talha. So he had seven of the Ashara. And the Prophet ﷺ said to Hira, but it does not mention that Hira was shaking in this version. Yeah, the Prophet ﷺ said to Hira, be firm, O Hira, because you have on you a Nabi, a Siddiq, a Shaheed, and nothing else. You only have Nabi, Siddiq, or Shaheed in this combination. And so, obviously, Talha is of the Shuhada. And as well, it is narrated in Sahih Bukhari that when Umar radiallahu anh was stabbed and he was about to die, he chose the six and then he said that these are the six tuwfiya Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa hum anhu radin. That the Prophet passed away and he was happy with these six. So Umar is saying that these six people, the Prophet was happy with them. Okay, so that is another blessing, that a sahabi is testifying that the Prophet is pleased with Talha when he passed away. According to most reports, Talha was born around 28 years before the Hijrah, which means he embraced Islam at the very young age of 15. So Talha embraced Islam as a 15-year-old. Young teenager. And one of the earliest historiographers of Islam, Ibn Manda, who wrote a book about the Sahaba, he says that Talha was brownish in complexion with a lot of hair like going down, very handsome, shorter height, not very tall, shorter than usual, with broad shoulders. And this is what we'll get, also a brownish complexion, which is the standard complexion of the Arabs at the time. Now Ibn Sa'd mentions that something happened to him before his conversion, and that is that he was in the markets of Basra, not Basra, Basra. We said many times, not Basra of Iraq, Basra of Syria, right? Basra of Sham. And he was in the marketplace because he and his father were both businessmen. And he would go and buy and sell. And they were from a very wealthy family. Talha was from a wealthy family and he remained wealthy for his entire life, as we will come to. So he was in the marketplace of Basra. And he found a monk there asking, is anybody from Mecca? Is anybody from Mecca? So Talha said, I am from Mecca. So the monk said, has Ahmed appeared yet? So Talha said, who is Ahmed? So the monk said, a prophet is going to come, his time has come, and he will appear from your land. So Talha went back, and that is when he heard that the Prophet had begun preaching, and he met Abu Bakr, and then the conversion happened. Okay, so this is also mentioned, and as we know, these types of things have been mentioned many times in the seerah about such stories. And Talha ibn Ubaydullah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, made him a brother to Zubayr ibn Awam, even in Mecca. If you remember, we mentioned this very early on, that the mu'akha, it took place twice, once in Mecca and once in Medina. So even in Mecca, there was a mu'akha amongst the early Muslims, like people are made brothers. And then in Medina, it was done again. People are made brothers again. So in Mecca, the Prophet ﷺ made Zubayr and Talha brothers. And when the Hijrah took place, when the Hijrah took place to Habasha, to Abyssinia, Talha had no need to go because he was a very respected member of the Quraysh. And there was no problems with him being a Muslim, with his Banu Taym. And who else was from Banu Taym? Abu Bakr. And Abu Bakr also, did he go to Habasha? No. The Banu Taym, they were not as crude or as harsh as some of the other tribes. And they did not persecute their converts. So look at how qabali it is, right? Look at how tribal it is. That depending on your tribe, then. And Abu Bakr, when was he harmed the most? When he physically attempted to defend the Prophet ﷺ. Then he got involved. Otherwise, as a Taymi, he was not harmed. And Talha, we don't read of any actual persecution done against Talha because number one, he was from the tribe of Taym. Number two, he himself was socioeconomically, his father was wealthy. And you know, when you're wealthy, you get privileges. This is the reality of the world that we live in. When you have that money, that you get those perks. And his father was a wealthy man, and Talha obviously is also involved in the trade. So it does not appear that we don't really find that Talha faced the type of persecution that the physical persecution that some of the other early Muslims were not from the Quraysh faced. And that's why, by the way, look at who were the people that were suffering the most, the non-Qurashi, and especially the non-Arabs. Especially the non-Arabs, okay? Such as Bilal, such as Sumayya, she wasn't an Arab, and she was the first Shahida. She wasn't an Arab. And Yasir was technically an Arab, but you know how their Unsuriyah and their Jahiliyyah was. He was from the lowest qabila of Arabs, very low class of Arabs, so he wasn't considered to be a high stock of the Arabs. And so there was no problem getting rid of him and killing him as well. And Ibn Mas'ud was also harassed and intimidated, and he wasn't from the higher. So you get the point here. As for Talha, nothing, because he is from the Banu Taym. And he had that element of izzah that he wasn't physically harmed as far as we know. And in fact, it is even narrated that. So he did not migrate to Habasha. And when the Prophet ﷺ migrated to Medina, he was in fact at that time on an expedition in Syria. So what this indicates is that he is still buying and selling as a Muslim, and he's not getting that type of persecution that some of the other Sahaba had. And this is subhanAllah, ذَلِكَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ, that's Allah blessed him, that his tribe was more cordial and accepting than other sub-tribes. So he didn't have that type of persecution that the others did. So in fact, he's actually in Syria, and it is said that on the way down, when he passed by Medina, he heard that the Prophet ﷺ is coming to Medina, but he didn't get him in Medina. Then he met Abu Bakr and the Prophet ﷺ outside of Medina by a day or two. So he met them on the way down. Now that they're so far away, so they're not hiding anymore, they're rushing to Medina. So Talha tells them that the people of Medina are waiting for you. The people in Medina are waiting for you. And according to Ibn Ishaq, Talha actually gifted the Prophet and Abu Bakr new garments that he just got from Syria. So gifted them good looking garments so that they can enter Medina. So Talha is the one who gifted them the garments that they wore when they entered Medina. And so he went back to Mecca after that trip, and he sold whatever he needed to sell, and he then brought his family and also the family of Abu Bakr. So Aisha and Abdul Rahman, they came with Talha, because remember, Talha is basically their uncle from the same tribe, not the first uncle, but you get the point. Essentially, he's an uncle of the family, right? So he's the one who brings Aisha, and he's the one who brings Abdurrahman, and he's the one who also brings his mother and others in the hijrah to Medina. And when they arrive in Medina, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made him a brother to one of the most elite of the Ansar, Abu Ayyub al-Ansari. Abu Ayyub al-Ansari and Talha then become the Mu'akha. Remember the Mu'akha. And the Prophet ﷺ allowed him to choose his plot of land around the masjid. So Talha had a relatively close house because the Prophet ﷺ allowed him to basically choose his location of the house. Now, Talha did not participate in the Battle of Badr physically, yet he is considered a Badri. There are very few people, such as Uthman. Talha is another example, where for whatever reason, and we'll explain right now, they didn't actually fight, but they're considered Badri. And they got a share of the ghanima. And they got the reward of the battle, even though they were not on the battlefield. How so? So as we remember, the story of Badr was that the Prophet and the Sahaba initially wanted to catch the caravan of Abu Sufyan. Correct? Wanted to catch the caravan. And the Prophet ﷺ was not intending to meet the Quraysh. He didn't want the 1,000 people to, he didn't even know. Remember, they found out the last day. Correct, remember? They literally found out a few days before. Now, well, now what do we do? Do we attack? Do we not? So before they found out, and they're still trying to hunt down the caravan, the Prophet ﷺ sent two trustworthy people to go find the whereabouts of the caravan and then come back and report, then we can go and attack. And the person that was sent was Talha ibn Ubaydullah, along with another Sahabi. So Talha was sent on a scouting expedition. And in fact, Talha did track the caravan down. And he rushed back to try to basically tell him, oh, they're taking a different road. Because remember, that was the whole point, right? So Talha figured out they're taking a different road. He's trying to get back in time, but obviously by the time he gets back, Badr's over. Okay? Badr's over, and obviously you understand there's no communication, there's no cell phone, there's nothing. So what can be done? So Talha radiallahu an misses the actual battle, but on the same time, he's clearly a part of the army. In fact, he played a very instrumental role. He was sent on a very dangerous expedition. And therefore, when he returned, the Prophet ﷺ considered him a Badri and gave him his share of the ghanima as if he had participated fully. Because he's a part of the army in the end of the day. He left his home and he wanted to go and fight and he wanted to get, but he wasn't able to do that. And so the Prophet ﷺ gave him his share of the ghanima. And when he gave him the share, Talha said, and how about my ajr, Ya Rasulullah? Do I get my ajr? And the Prophet ﷺ said, yes, your ajr as well. You get it all. You get the ghanima and you get your ajr as well. Now, Talha radiallahu anhu, what he really, yani what clearly raised him above the ranks of every other person really is the Battle of Uhud. Talha is associated with the Battle of Uhud. That is where Talha radiallahu anhu rose up and did what no other sahabi did. And that's Qadr Allah. They weren't there the way that Talha was. And Talha demonstrated his iman on the battlefield of Uhud. And essentially what happened at Uhud was that Talha radiallahu anhu was the senior most sahabi who never ever left the side of the Prophet ﷺ throughout the entire day. Even Abu Bakr was not able to find the Prophet ﷺ. He never left the Prophet ﷺ. But you know, in the heat of the battle, then the Prophet ﷺ went and Abu Bakr could not find him for some period. And Abu Bakr had to redouble back and go find him. So the person there was with the Prophet ﷺ, a small group of people. And the senior most sahabi that was with him constantly throughout the day was none other than Talha ibn Ubaydullah. And that's where the ranks of Talha rose up. That the sheer quantity of wounds and stabs and basically lacerations that he achieved essentially almost brought him to the verge of death and paralyzed his hand for the rest of his life. And he had actually a few digits, we don't know how many, at least as much research as I couldn't find out how many, but either a finger or more were cut off. So he was missing a finger. And on top of that, well, I'm jumping the gun, let's get to, so we're getting the effects of Uhud. So what happened at Uhud? So Uhud, Talha was with the Prophet ﷺ continuously from the very beginning of when Khalid ibn Walid attacked back all the way to the end. Talha was there. And in At-Tirmidhi we learned that when the Prophet ﷺ was forced to basically turn his back and face and find protection in the mountains, he is climbing up the mountains. And in Sunan At-Tirmidhi, we have the hadith here, I can quote it directly, but it is there in Tirmidhi, that they came across a place where in order to get to that cave, there was no opening. And the rock to climb was too high to climb. And Talha then went down on his hands and knees. And the Prophet ﷺ stood up on him to get to that level. Because you know, you imagine you're climbing a mountain, right? So Talha literally stood down like this, and the Prophet ﷺ got on his back to get to that higher level, and they continued onwards. And the Prophet ﷺ said at this point, أَوْجَبَ Talha. Talha is now wajib. Yani what Talha is doing, أَوْجَبَ Talha, it is now wajib. And Talha as well, it is narrated that when they got to that cavern, that cave, we know, and I mentioned this in the Battle of Uhud, we did this, there were at least 11 of the Ansar, and Talha, and a few more. We don't know their names. And these 11 Ansar and Talha, when a contingent from Khalid ibn al-Walid's forces came, the Prophet said, who is going to take care of them? And Talha stood up and said, me. And the Prophet said, sit down. So another Ansari said, I will do it. So he went out and he kind of deflected, protected, and they went on, and then he was killed. Then another group comes, because remember, they're in that little cave, and they're trying to basically make sure nobody sees them in that cave. Right? You well went over the battle of Uhud. And another one goes out. Once again, Talha says, I'll be the one. The Prophet says, no, sit down. Another one. And we learn 11 of that small entourage, one after the other, they defend and they meet their fate. And until finally, Talha is the one that is left. And the Prophet said, okay, go Talha now. And so Talha fights the fighting of all 11. That's what the narrator says. He fought the fighting of all 11. And it was in that fighting that essentially his entire body was wounded. That he had a stab that came to his hand, that came to his hand, and it cut off either one digit or more. He had multiple lacerations until finally when, let me quote you the hadith in Bukhari, before I get there, that when Talha was fighting in this particular incident right now, and a sword came down and cut off that finger, as we said, and Talha said, hiss. We said this in the lecture that I gave so many years ago. He said, hiss. And hiss is the Arabic equivalent of ouch. It's like, ouch, I mean hiss, is like that. And the Prophet said, if you had just said Bismillah right now, the angels would have lifted you up even as the Quraysh are watching. Like you've reached such a high maqam right now, if you had just said Bismillah, rather than a word that's not good but not bad, it's just a generic word, right? Then angels would have lifted you up even as the Quraysh are, even as the Quraysh are looking. And Talha was also of those who they gave a special bay'ah amongst themselves on that day, that we will fight until death. Now the Arabs had this custom, and the Muslims, early Islam, in the time of the Prophet, they took the custom, and in fact it is known even to this day amongst army people and whatnot, that they basically give an oath to themselves that, you know what, we're not going to go back defeated, we'll either win or we'll die. This is the oath of death. And on the day of Uhud, an elite group of Sahaba gave that oath of death. Talha was amongst them. That, khalas, this is it. Either we die or we're going to be victorious. There is no third opportunity or ground for us. So Talha was of those who did that oath. And in Bukhari it is mentioned that Qais ibn Hazm says, I saw the hand of Talha become paralyzed on the day of Uhud, protecting the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Qais ibn Abi Hazm says, on the day of Uhud, his hand became paralyzed, and he could not raise his hand when he gave the bay'ah to Uthman and to Ali as well. He literally had to take his left hand and lift up the right hand and put it on. Okay, so his hand could not even be lifted anymore because of the wounds of that day. And Aisha reports that whenever the battle of Uhud was mentioned, Abu Bakr would say, that is a day that belongs to Talha, all of it. That is a day Talha is our hero. So Abu Bakr is saying that Talha is the hero of the battle of Uhud. And Abu Bakr narrates that I was the first person to come back to the Prophet, meaning I was the first to find him. Talha didn't have to find him because he was with him. I was the first to double back and find the Prophet ﷺ. And as soon as I came to the Prophet ﷺ, what did the Prophet ﷺ say? Go take care of Talha. Subhanallah. Go take care. Even though the Prophet ﷺ himself was injured and bleeding, he himself was there. But Talha was one hair's width away from death. Talha was, there was a fear he would be gone. That's how serious. So as soon as Abu Bakr came, the Prophet said, go take care of Talha. Right? And of course, Abu Bakr is not going to take care of Talha until he takes care of the Prophet. Correct. So he took care of the Prophet, did what he could. Then they went and they went to the body of Talha that was lying there. And Abu Bakr said that he had akthar min sab'een, more than 70 wounds on his body. Front and back. 70 injuries on one day. And His finger had been cut off. So again, we get this notion that a sword had come and there was basically the finger had been cut off. And in the Mustadrak of Al-Hakim, in a hadith reported by the Prophet in a hadith that the Prophet said, I remember on the day of Uhud, a time came when all I could see was Jibreel on my right hand side and Talha on my left hand side. There was nobody left. We just mentioned everybody had died from the Ansar. So there was a time, the only person I could see, Jibreel and Talha, that were protecting me. And so, on the day of Uhud, and of course we also learned that Talha as well was shielding the body of the Prophet from arrows. Right? And that is more than one person. Sa'd as well did this, but Talha as well did this, right? So Talha as well was one of those who is shielding the body, and that is why there were wounds on the front and on the back. Because whatever he's trying to do, whenever he tries to see something, whatever he can do, he's putting his body between what's coming and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that is why there are so many 70 wounds. So because the Battle of Uhud wounded him so severely, Allah knows best, this is my analysis, we don't find anything after the Battle of Uhud of him doing, he participated, means his name is on the list, but we don't have any specific deeds, and that makes complete sense. His hand is not, his right hand, you cannot do anything with it. So he's physically there, he's doing whatever can be done, but he's not at the forefront, he can't be. He's now, I mean, what is the term? I don't want to say disabled, but you get the point. I mean, he's not slightly handicapped, even the word handicapped, I don't know, is he fully handicapped? You get the point. He's like, he cannot be at the forefront anymore because of the Battle of Uhud. Nonetheless, he actively participates, let's put it this way, in every single other battle. And he dons the armor and he goes to the battlefield, but we don't have specific incidents, and it's understood why we don't, because he could not be at the forefront. So he's at the Battle of Khandaq, he's at the conquest of Mecca, he's at the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, his name is in all of these. But as far as I could research, we don't have any specific incidents coming from it. And again, this makes complete sense, that his bravery is not going to stop him from going, but at the same time, he should not be at the forefront anyway, because that's not the best warrior at this point in time because of what happened to him at Uhud. And so we learned that Talha did not miss any battle of the Prophet ﷺ. Even Badr, he is considered to be a part of Badr, despite the fact that he didn't actually participate. And then during the time of the Khulafa Ar-Rashidoon, Talha was the one who, when Abu Bakr was dying, and he went to each and or every Sahabi was called to him, Talha was also called and he said, "What do you think of Umar al-Khattab?" Talha was the only one who was brave enough and clear enough and frank enough to say, "Have you considered, O Abu Bakr, what will you say when Allah asks you about the strictness of Umar?" And look at even the question, subhanAllah. He's not even saying, "Don't put Umar, he's too strict." Rather, he is saying, "Do you have an answer to this question? That when Allah will ask you, you appointed Umar and you knew he was strict, right? What will you say?" And he was on his deathbed. Abu Bakr got up and he said, "I will say back to Allah that, O Allah, I put the person that I trusted the most of the Ummah of Muhammad ﷺ in charge." It means I know I'm going to have this response ready. So what the point for us is the frankness of Talha. And who other than Talha could be so frank and blunt that he's not against Umar, astaghfirullah. But he's saying, "Oh Abu Bakr, are you sure because of this one characteristic?" So the only person who was that brave and that frank and had that the standing to actually say this is Talha ibn Ubaydullah. And then during the time of Umar, of course, as well, Talha plays a role amongst the viziers. Basically, these group of Sahaba, they're like the advisory committee. You know, there's no parliament, but what the closest we'll have to an advisory committee. Talha is of the, let's call it the inner circle of Umar al-Khattab. When Umar passes away, of course, Talha is in the six, as Umar says, that these are the six people the Prophet ﷺ died, and he was pleased with all of them, and I know all of them. So these are the six, he's in the six. And as we all know that within a day, these six came down to three because each one nominated somebody that they would rather have. And Talha was the first one to get out. And Talha was the first to get out. And he nominated Uthman ibn Affan, Okay, so Talha nominated Uthman ibn Affan and he said, I don't want it anymore. Then it was Uthman, Ali and Abdurrahman ibn Auf, remember, right? And then Abdurrahman ibn Auf said, would you agree if I get out that I will decide between the two of you? And then, you know, 3 days went by. Okay, but the point is, Talha was of the first to say, I don't want it. You can have it, Uthman, have my share and I'm out. And the same happened with the three others. So, Talha was the one who nominated Uthman. However, and we mentioned this in the time of Uthman's lecture that I gave, he became mildly critical of some of the policies of Uthman towards the end of Uthman's life, radiallahu anhu. Okay? So, Talha, radiallahu anhu, disagreed with some of the policies of Uthman. And perhaps at the beginning, when it wasn't clear what was going to happen, perhaps he was maybe physically in the crowd when Uthman could still come to the masjid and when it was like a negotiation. Once the crowd became rowdy and violent, Talha went away. So Talha was definitely not a part of anything that happened physically. But unfortunately, because of the association from the beginning, this kind of left a bitter taste in the Umayyads, early Umayyads. Okay? Because Talha, radiallahu anhu, was of those who mildly criticized in the beginning, and he sympathized with some of the complaints. But then, as we said, remember in the beginning, the complainers gathered in the masjid, he spoke to them, Uthman spoke to them directly. Perhaps Talha was in that first gathering, let's say. But once the siege began, Talha has nothing to do with this at all. And no Sahabi participated, much less Talha, in the spiraling out of events that took place. But nonetheless, this is what happens, unfortunately, when tongues wag and people talk and whatnot. So he was kind of sort of linked with them, even though he did not actually have a part in the actual physical, if you like, blockage of the house, much less with the actual killing of Uthman. And therefore, when Uthman radiallahu anhu was massacred, Talha felt immensely guilty. The guilt was massive in him. And that is why, eventually, what did he do? He was one of those, along with Zubair, who went to Mecca to visit Aisha when she had not come back from Hajj. And then all of them said, we can't continue like this. 6, 7, 8 months have gone by. We need to march to Basra. We need to find our support in the people of Basra. And we need to, as a group, as a large, you know, basically group of people, I don't want to call it an army because we said the intention was never to fight Ali, that we will demand, our voice will be heard, that Uthman's, radiallahu anhu's killers is going to be brought to justice. And so, Talha radiallahu anhu, it is narrated that on the day of the Battle of Camel, he basically said something similar, that, you know, I didn't defend Uthman the way that I should have, but today I will defend him the way that I should. So this clearly shows that Talha radiallahu anhu was not sympathetic to the crowd that went beyond what is acceptable. As we said, it is acceptable to disagree with the policies of the Sahaba. That's not beyond the pale of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, right? You can agree or disagree. And Talha disagreed with some of the policies of Uthman, so be it, okay. We're allowed to disagree. But obviously when the situation spiraled out of control, Talha had nothing to do with that. But still he felt guilty that for whatever thing that he was, I mean, and again, to be honest, we don't even know what role or whatever, how much he was. But nonetheless, in the beginning of the siege, sorry, not the siege, in the beginning of the crowds coming, Talha radiallahu anhu was associated with them. There is an assumption that maybe those crowds used his name more than they should have. You know what it happens, you know, like my support and whatnot. Allah knows best. So, we know that Talha and Zubair, of course, were on the side of Aisha in the Battle of the Camel. And a few weeks ago, or 2 weeks ago, I mentioned what happened. And that is that Ali radiallahu anhu sent a message, and specifically to Talha and Zubair, that look, you know, this is not appropriate, we shouldn't be fighting and whatnot. And so Talha and Zubair, they both agreed that there should not be war. And when the people began to draw their swords, Talha radiallahu anhu was on his horse and he was running back and forth in his own army, in his own group, saying, put your swords back, we're not going to be fighting, put your swords back. And as he was doing that, an arrow comes, and there was a place in the armor that was weak and there was an opening, and the arrow was aimed for that. And these are people, I don't know, subhanAllah, it's just really amazing to think about this, but that's how they were back then. That was their sharpshooting of the era. And so the arrow comes and pierces him, and he dies essentially on the spot, on the day of the Battle of the Camel. And he was 62, or some say 64 years old. So 62 or 64 years old. And it is mentioned that Ali radiallahu anhu, when the battle was over, he held up the body of Talha and he began to wipe the dust from the face of Talha. And he said, إِلَى اللَّهِ أَشْتَكِي, I complain to Allah of our situation, of my situation. يَا لَيْتَنِي مِتُّ قَبْلَ هَذَا وَكُنْتُ نَسْيًا مَنْسِيًا, which is in the Quran. How I wish I never lived to see this day. How I wish I never saw what I'm seeing, that I have to see the body of Talha being killed in this manner. And it is mentioned that Talha's son entered in upon Ali radiallahu anhu after the battle was over, and Ali welcomed him, embraced him, hugged him, and said, I make dua to Allah, I pray that your father and I are amongst those whom Allah has said in the Quran, وَنَزَعْنَا مَا فِي صُدُورِهِمْ مِنْ غِلٍّ إِخْوَانًا عَلَى سُرُرٍ مُتَقَابِلِينَ, that we are of those whom Allah says in the Quran, we have removed the animosity from their hearts, and they are in Jannah facing one another on couches. And again, this is what we expect of the Sahaba. There are some modern narrators and commentators and wa'adh and khutaba who sugarcoat to the point of ridiculousness that there was no animosity. There clearly was. Wars took place. People died. You know, especially between Ali and Muawiyah and Aisha, even there was radiallahu anhum ajma'in. But this is what we expect. There are others who make the animosity bigger than it was. This is what we expect. So what if there was some not getting along? Wallahi, as I've said so many times, no matter how righteous and pious you are, I am, and none of us is that righteous like the Sahaba at all, but still, no matter how good a person is, you don't get along with everybody, do you? There are personal issues that take place, you know. There are people that you just don't like, and other people like that person, you don't like that person. That's how life is, right? So the Sahaba are actually no different, but they didn't make these differences personal. And they understood that, look, we disagreed, there are some issues in our hearts, but look at what Ali radiallahu anhu is saying, that I am optimistic that your father and me are what Allah says in the Quran, that we are both in Jannah, and we're going to be facing one another, and we have nothing of enmity in our hearts. وَنَزَعْنَا مَا فِي صُدُورِهِمْ مِنْ غِلٍّ إِخْوَانًا عَلَى سُرُرٍ مُتَقَابِلِينَ. So Talha radiallahu anhu, he passed away on the day of the Battle of the Camel, and therefore he was buried essentially in what is now the city of Basra, outside, but now it is inside the city of Basra, and his grave has remained a well-known place to this day. And in fact, the Iraqi government built a masjid basically on the grave. And then when this ISIS group took over, what do you think they did to that masjid? They blew it up. So that masjid was blown up. But the grave is well known. The grave is well known. Where Talha's grave is, it is known to this day. Now, Talha radiallahu anhu, some final points about him. Talha radiallahu anhu did not narrate that many ahadith. In fact, probably less than 20 are narrated from Talha. Very little. And this is to be expected from multiple ways. Firstly, he himself felt very hesitant to narrate from the Prophet ﷺ. Secondly, not every Sahabi was associated with hadith narration and knowledge. Some Sahaba are into this, some Sahaba are into that. And we have to expect this, as we have said many times, that not every person is exactly the same. So, what Khalid ibn al-Walid is known for is not hadith narration. What Abu Hurairah is known for is not battlefield tactics. But the Ummah needs Khalid and Abu Hurairah. And each one has a role to play. So Talha radiallahu anhu, even though he lived until the time of Ali radiallahu anhu, he was not associated with hadith narration. And he was a relatively quiet person as well. And he was not of those to basically have hadith circles. Talha as well, in terms of his family, as is typical. He had, mashallah, tabarakallah, many, many children. As is typical, again, for the time, he married many, many women. And again, and it's very common in those days, as we know, so many of the Sahaba, they would marry, divorce. It was very common back then. So Talha married at least 9 women in his life. At least 9 women, if not more. And what's very interesting, as one of the early scholars said, is that 4 of these women were sisters to our mothers. They were sister-in-laws of the Prophet ﷺ. Right? So Talha, being such a senior Sahabi from a senior tribe of the Quraysh, and also, as we'll come to, wealthy as well. So 4 of his wives were sister-in-laws of the Prophet ﷺ. And I don't know of any other Sahabi that had this privilege. So of them is Umm Kulthum binti Abi Bakr, who is of course sister's Aisha. So Aisha's younger sister Umm Kulthum, he married. Of them is Hamana binti Jahsh, who is the sister of Zainab binti Jahsh. Of them is Fari'a binti Abi Sufyan, who is the sister of Ummi Habiba Ramla binti Abi Sufyan. And of them is Ruqayya, the sister of Ummi Salama. Okay, so Aisha, Zainab, Ummi Habiba, Ummi Salama, all of their sisters were wives of Talha ibn Ubaydullah. Okay, and from these multiple women, not just these 4, but all of his wives, he had at least 11 sons and 4 daughters. So a total at least of 15, if not more, at least 15 children. And subhanAllah, something very, very beautiful. He loved to name his children by the names of the prophets. So when you look at the books of Tariq and the books of they're called the Tarajim of the Sahaba, the biographies of the Sahaba. So his sons are Muhammad, Musa, Yaqub, Ismail, Ishaq, Zakariya, Yusuf, Yahya, Isa, and on, mashallah, tabarakallah. So he loved to name his children the names of the Sahaba. Sorry, the names of the prophets. So essentially all of his children are named after the prophets. And finally, Talha radiallahu anh was of the wealthiest companions and also of the most generous. He was extremely wealthy, rivaling Uthman ibn Affan. And he was extremely generous as well, rivaling Uthman ibn Affan. But Uthman probably preceded him in his generosity. But maybe Talha was richer than Uthman, maybe. And again, who was going to calculate that? But Talha was definitely of the wealthiest of the Sahaba. And at times he would dress according to his wealth. One of the Tabi'un reported that he once saw Talha wearing a garment that was worth at least 1,000 dirhams. At least 1,000 dirhams. And another Tabi'i said, I do not know of anyone whom money comes to easier without any effort like Talha. Money just comes to Talha. And along with this wealth, there was generosity, the likes of which as well are legendary. In one narration, Ibn Sa'd in his Tabaqat, he mentions one particular incident that caused Talha to donate in one night all the wealth that was in his house. And somebody asked, how much was it at that time? So he responded, not Talha, but the servant who did it, 400,000 dirhams in one night. 400,000 dirhams were given in one night. And one year when the people of Medina were facing a food crisis, Talha single-handedly purchased grain for the entire city of Medina and fed the whole city from his wealth. So when Allah Azza wa Jal gives and you are that generous, what's going to happen? Allah will give you much more. And that's what we see in the life of Talha. That literally, and subhanAllah, when you look at the ideal, so money is coming to them. Literally, we can say that people like Talha were the equivalents of multimillionaires. But you can see that their heart is not attached to the money. You can see it in their lives and in their generosity. And this is the epitome of iman and taqwa and of richness. Have all the money, but your heart is not attached to that money. And it is also mentioned that when he passed away, they couldn't calculate the number of wealth that he has. And according to one, it was 100 of 100,000 coins. Like we would say like 1 million or 10 million coins, right? And he had hundreds of properties and wells. So this is quite literally what we would call a multimillionaire. To own properties and wells and hundreds of thousands of coins. This is something that, yani, think about that. But at the same time, one of the most famous tabi'un, As-Sa'ib ibn Yazid, he said, I accompanied Talha while he was traveling and in his house. I was with him. And I never even heard of anybody who was more generous than him in wealth. He would give money and clothes and food like no one else. So this is a very famous tabi'i, As-Sa'ib ibn Yazid. Everybody knows him who knows hadith. He's a very famous narrator. And he narrates from Talha and others, Sahaba. And he goes, I never even heard of somebody more generous. Like literally, wherever he'd go, he's giving money and food and clothes. He's not just generous with money. Whatever he has, he's sharing with other people. So this is Talha ibn Ubaydullah. And this is honestly pretty much all that we know about him. Very else little is left other than to quote some hadith or whatnot. But really, this is all that we know about Talha ibn Ubaydullah. And definitely one of the people that we should now memorize his name. One of the Ashara Mubash'ara, a person whom we admire immensely and greatly respect. Just a quick footnote. And not that we care, but we should just know that the other group, the non-Sunni group, unfortunately their stance towards him is the exact opposite as our stance. And that is because Talha was on the side of Aisha fighting against Ali. And so, astaghfirullah, we should just know this. From their perspective, he is not even a Muslim. La hawla la quwwata illa billah. So they say that particular Sahaba are not Muslim, and of them is Talha because he was on the other side. And this is an exaggeration in the case of Ali ibn Abi Talib. And look at how different Ali radiallahu anhu is from those who claim to be his followers and his Shia. Look at the difference of Ali and those who claim to be his followers. Ali radiallahu anhu himself holds the body of Talha and he wipes the dust from his face. And he says, Ya laytani mittu qabla hada. And he says, I wish I had never had to see this day. And when Talha's son comes, he goes, I am positive, inshallah, arju. It means I'm optimistic that your father and me will be in Jannah together. And the people who think they are partisan of Ali, their view is the exact opposite of Ali radiallahu anhu. And that is why I keep on saying, we are the true Shi'atu Ali and Shi'atu Hussein. I say this over and over again. We are the ones who give them the respect they deserve, and we believe in them the way they deserve to be believed in, and we follow their perspective even of the Sahaba, because they did not make takfir of any of the Sahaba. Even Ali and Muawiyah did not make takfir of one another. So we are the ones who truly support and follow them. And we are the people who love all of the Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Inshallah, with that we will conclude for today. And then next week, inshallah, we'll do the Hawariyu Rasulillah, the disciple and the one who protected the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that is Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam. Inshallah, with that we break for Salah. Oh, one point about our halaqa. So the Tuesday halaqa, I have been advised, and I agree with this 100%, that it should not be on Tuesdays. And that is because it is difficult for many of you to come. And we know from our experiences as well that we don't get a large group on Tuesdays. Rather, what has been advised, and I completely agree, we should scrap the Tuesday format. And rather, once a month, we have a half day Saturday. And we intensively study whatever I wanted to do over 6 weeks of Tuesday, 1 hour each. We basically do an entire half day and then we continue another Saturday of another month. So inshallah ta'ala, that is what we're going to be doing. Probably the second or third week of October, we'll get an email advertisement. Inshallah, we'll be doing an intensive halaqa all day Saturday, inshallah. As for the topic, then will be decided in the next few days, inshallah. Oh, go ahead. Bismillah.
One quick question and a yes and no answer, whether Najashi is included in those because he was preyed upon. That was the first. Whether is he in the list of those going to Jannah? The second question is those, the Ashara Mubash'ara, they mentioned the first four in the same sequence based on, you said, that they are Khulafa. But when the Khulafa was selected, this was obviously they didn't enjoy the extra hierarchy because there was a different process for all four Khulafa. So this was the list that you provided, have the four names. The top four are the same in both the lists. But that wasn't relevant in the selection of the caliphs. Because
so I'll answer your second one first. Actually, some narrations of the hadith mention Uthman and then Ali, and some mention Ali, then Uthman.
But even then, the selection was the Umar's selection. If it was known that this would be the sequence,
that's because the Sahaba did not think that the hadith was any sequence.
Exactly. That's what I was saying. Yeah.
They didn't assume the hadith implied a sequence. So they didn't use it in this process. As for your question about Najashi, so again, there are people whose assumption is that indeed they are in Jannah, but nothing explicit has been narrated, right? So the fact that the Prophet ﷺ prayed over Najashi and he said, he is your brother in faith, clearly it's there. But the explicit wording that Najashi is in Jannah has not been narrated. So he doesn't get that status as the rest of the Sahaba, Abu Bakr fil Jannah, Umar fil Jannah, Uthman fil Jannah. That is for the Ashara Mubash'ara.
The people who are not amongst the 10, but in there, or there were indications that they are going to Jannah even after the death. You mentioned these different categories.
So we call them Mubash'arun bil Jannah.
Yeah.
But we don't say the Ashara Mubash'ara. As I said in the beginning, the Ashara Mubash'ara are a separate category. But the Mubash'arun are more than Ashara. So we call them all Mubash'arun bil Jannah, inshaAllah.